Hi, I'm Jim Arraj, and today we're going to talk about Jung's psychological types. In fact, we're not just going to talk about them, but we're going to meet people who embody each one of the 8 basic psychological types. Jung's typology is a powerful and effective way in which we can understand and deal with normal and natural human differences. But it can only work for us if we overcome certain misunderstandings about it. First of all, psychological types is not something Jung dreamed up and then tried to apply to his patients. Rather, it grew out of his own experience, and if it doesn't grow out of our experience, it will always remain a parlor game with no real practical significance. Just what is psychological types? It's a way we can see ourselves afresh and understand the people around us. Psychological types can be divided into 2 basic parts. The first is type recognition, which we're going to be dealing with today, and the second is type development or inner transformation. Let's talk for a minute about type recognition. If someone told us that a few minutes of paging through a book about birds would enable us to identify a bird flashing overhead, we would be rightly skeptical. There are some things that can only be learned by experience, and type recognition is one of those things. While it is not particularly difficult, it does take time and an understanding of basic type terminology. When Jung started working on types, he first described what he called introversion and extroversion. These words have become part of popular language today, but Jung gave them very distinctive meanings. They describe the basic flow of our energy, interest, and attention. Jung insisted that every one of us is both introverted and extroverted, but usually one predominates over the other. The result is we have people who are quite outgoing, for example. Their energy and attention flows out to the people and things around them. These people and things capture most of their time and attention. This doesn't mean that these outgoing people, or what Jung would call extroverts, are not also reflective or inward-looking. They are, but their outward-going part of themselves predominates. With the introverts, it's just the opposite. Their energy and attention flow inward to the world within, and this world is not simply the world of their ego, as if they were somehow just egocentric. But it is much wider than that. It's an inner world that Jung calls the collective unconscious. So for introverts, most of their energy flows inward, yet since they are living in this world too, some of their energy and attention flows out to it. So the first issue in type recognition is whether someone is more introverted or extroverted. Well, after Jung had formulated these notions, he grew puzzled. They seemed to be too simplistic for the kinds of differences he was seeing among people. Finally, after a great deal of effort, he came to the conclusion that there were different kinds of introversion and extroversion, and he described these different kinds under the headings of what he called the 4 functions of thinking and feeling, sensation, and intuition. Once again, Jung was convinced that we possess all these functions, but some of them are more developed in us than others. Let's look at the question of thinking and feeling. By thinking, Jung meant pretty much what we mean by it today. Thinking is using our powers of reasoning. It's logically organizing our thoughts in order to come to a decision about something. But Jung decided that thinking was just one way of arriving at a decision. The other way was by feeling. By feeling, Jung didn't mean emotions, but he meant a sense of rapport that we can have with people and things, which rapport tells us whether we like or dislike something, feel it is good or bad for us, and therefore arrive at a judgment or decision just as surely as if we had thought about it. Yet in this case, there is no orderly organization of ideas, but rather it is a more holistic process of rapport or lack of it. Jung discovered that there were two ways of perceiving things, which he called intuition and sensation. Sensation is easy to grasp because it means nothing more than using our five senses to focus on the world around us or the world within us with all its richness of detail, with all its color and sounds, its smells and tastes. By sensation, we are oriented to the here and now, to the present. Intuition is an equally valid way of perceiving things, but it is a bit harder to grasp. Intuition doesn't stop at sense details. It uses them as a springboard to bound ahead and try to sniff out hidden possibilities in any situation. It's not present-oriented, but future-oriented. For example, if an extroverted sensation type comes into a room, he or she is aware of the color of the walls, how many people are there, what the furnishings are like, and so forth. But the intuition type may be oblivious to most of these details and sees something or someone that triggers off his or her intuition. For example, the intuition type may see a painting on the wall that reminds her that she has wanted to go to a museum in a distant city, and then she thinks about the plane trip there and the other things she would be doing, and so she's living in the future, sometimes at the price of the present. Jung discovered that these various kinds of introversion or extroversion, these four functions, have various strengths within us. If, for example, extroverted thinking is our primary way of judging and coming to decisions, then the other way of arriving at a decision, that is feeling, and in this case it would be introverted feeling, will be our weakest function. It is these various combinations of the functions, both introverted and extroverted, that give rise to the eight basic psychological types. I don't want to go into any more detail about the relationships that are found among the various functions in each of us, but what I would like to do is give you a sense of what the eight types are like in the concrete. We're going to meet eight different people, each one of whom embodies one of the eight types. These eight people are all friends of mine, and they work at various jobs. Their knowledge of Jung's types ranges from nothing to considerable. First, we're going to meet Charles, who is an introverted thinking type with intuition as his second function. Charles has worked as a teacher of creative writing at the college level, as well as a ship's machinist on the San Francisco waterfront. He has a good understanding of basic type terminology and good insight into his own type. Charles, are you more introverted or extroverted?
Clearly, my interest is me rather than externals. I mean, I wrote characters, example, I've never subscribed to a newspaper. I really don't care what's going on out there. What's going on in here is what's important to me. That world events. Typically, I'm always 10 years behind. You know, the Vietnam War is over, so I go get a history of it and read about it. But what's really
you know, important. You know, I'm me. Well, there's only one of me. I've got a limited amount of time. And what I'm thinking and feeling, and it's a matter of also of intensity of focus, focusing depth inward, you know, the whole world in my backyard, rather than spreading myself out thin. It's also a question of just how much data I can process, too, that I find there's just so much going on out there that I quickly get overwhelmed and have to come in and think about things. And a very small amount of, even a movie is extremely intense experience, and that some people will go to one night, next night, you know, I'm overloaded. And that's exactly my feeling. And people's, it's also a question of just how much data I can process, too, that I find there's just so much going on out there that I quickly get overwhelmed and have to come in and think about things. And a very small amount of, even a movie is extremely intense experience, and that some people will go to one night, next night, you know, I'm overloaded. And that's exactly my feeling. And people's, I need to think about things. I need to process data. And that I find that uncharacteristic of most people. They allow for great more audiovisual stimulation, just all kinds of stimulation from noise. Whereas I need my quiet. I need my privacy. I need my time. A new situation I find threatening. Yeah.
Give us an example.
Oh. God, any new situation. You're going to take a class in something. Right? Immediately, right? What are the rules? What are the parameters? Who's the good guys? Who's the bad guys? Job interviews. Shopping. it goes on and on and on. Especially where you have to break out of usual patterns and ask people for favors is a real characteristic thing. Where the merchandise isn't quite right and you have to return it, or you're driving someplace and you've lost your way and you need to ask directions. Well, I really hate to ask directions. I'd rather just keep driving than ask directions, right? I'm very reluctant to jump into a new situation. I don't find it a challenge or very interesting. I find it very threatening, you know? All these people, don't know them. And the situations I find comfortable are where I know the people from before and will talk to just a few rather than just many, yeah.
What predominates in you, thinking or feeling?
Okay, well, thinking, thoughts are always here. You're always, there's always kind of just a tape going by with sentences and words and questions and answers and noticing things and comparing things and remembering things and planning things. Whether you're awake or you're asleep. When your dreams, that often, like early morning when you're almost kind of awake and you slip back and forth, you're aware of yourself. You know, the computer up here never turns off.
What does feeling mean to you?
Don't really know. One has feelings. You're happy or glad or angry or stuff like that. But they're very slippery. They're very uncertain sorts of things. Sometimes they can be trusted, but they have to be backed up with logic. You know, that particularly aggravating is to be in a situation where you and another person are trying to evaluate someone, and they won't give their reasons, but they say, just, you know, this is the way I think about something, but what they're really saying is, this is the way I feel about it. And when you try to pin them down, they can't. And that's, you're saying, I'm sloppy, you know? you wanna, what are your reasons? Evidence, conclusions. That, yeah. So yeah, no, clearly. Evidence. I'm Western, you know, this is a scientific society. We're not, you know, I'm a product of my education and age, right? If they can't justify their choices in terms of facts, reasons, evidence, their feelings are illegitimate. You know, it's It's sloppy thinking. It's sloppy feeling. You just can't do that. Because it squirts all over. There's no starting point, no ending point, and it's very internal. And they say, well, this is just the way I feel, you know? And I say, well, tell me about it. And this is the way I feel. And it's impossible to negotiate, to understand. And so it's very arbitrary. Whereas thinking is non-arbitrary. You've got principles, and you've got conclusions, and you've got evidence, and it's also a causal method. If you say, hey, you know, A doesn't follow from B, the guy can say, oh, hey, yeah, you're right. Geez, you know, thank you very much. And it allows the possibility of interaction and cooperation. Whereas feeling, you know, how you cooperate, right? You're either on his trip or you're on your own trip, and it's people doing their things, and it's, yeah. Feelings are sloppy.
Which is stronger in you, sensation or intuition?
Okay, that's a tough one. Because I know in some situations, I work as a mechanic, I'm constantly into physical details. And I'm fairly good at noticing physical details. But when a situation is entirely laid out, everything is very explicit, it also goes very, very flat for me. I need that sort of hidden, dazzling, the hill over the next one that I can go explore. Okay, the old Daniel Boone syndrome. That's constant. And when everything is known, I feel trapped. I need escapes. I need outlets. I don't know. Huh. And so, yeah, I alternate between the two. Nah. Don't know. It depends on the situation. But yeah, probably intuition dominates in a sense of Peter Pan. You know, I need to be able to fly out the window and fly in the window. Yeah.
Of the four functions, which is your most developed function and which is your weakest function?
Okay, I'd have to say that thinking is probably my most developed function, because clearly feeling is my least developed function. I don't do well with people. I don't do well with feelings. I'm very embarrassed by feelings. It's only when I'm in a very known situation where I will express feelings of affection, prefer not to wear my feelings on a sleeve, very external, very private. Yeah, clearly, there's no question about it. Feeling is my least. It's a handicap and a limitation too. I realized that in my marriage, for example, it was almost a conscious choice. I picked a person who was very feeling oriented as a way of complimenting myself, and let her do the feeling sort of thing. I'll do the feeling for her function, making up for a deficiency through a relationship. No question about it. Compassion is a real clear example. Right, November 22nd, 1963, Kennedy gets shot. They say, hey, you know, too bad. It's one person. Why? What's the big deal? Everyone's aghast, you know, at my lack of compassion. And also other situations. Yeah, what was it? Okay, recently, the U.S. invades Panama. 15 guys get shot. I say, hey, what's the big deal? They killed that more in a weekend. You know, that justice, for me, is the old draconian sort of finger for finger, and have no sense of mercy, no sense of compassion. No, clearly, I know that. You know, that's the world I would prefer to be judged by and live by, rather than a sloppy sort of, well, you know, he made a mistake, let's forgive him. Yeah, so, and it's unfortunate because, yeah, I recognize it, but, you know, rationally I can't justify compassion. It upsets the rules.
Thank you, Charles. Next, we're going to meet my friend Lee. Lee works for the U.S. Forest Service and has worked on one of their highly trained hotshot firefighting teams. Lee is an extroverted feeling type, which makes her Charles's typological opposite. During this interview, her husband, Bob, is sitting on the sidelines. Lee, tell us about being extroverted.
If I'm working or just walking the dog or whatever, you know, I notice people walking down the road, and I'll say hello. if I'm working, you know, I'm usually the one who takes a lot of initiative, you know, and I don't feel self-conscious because basically I'm, you know, all that can happen is I'll just, you know, do it wrong and then I'll just, you know, learn. It's not a big deal. But some people have a problem with that, and I don't. You know, if I make a fool out of myself, then that's okay. It's just for a moment. I don't have problems making friends. You know, it's real easy to meet people, whether wherever it is, whether it's walking downtown or in the woods. You know, I don't feel threatened or anything if I'm in the middle of the woods and somebody comes up. You know, it's usually nice to have friendships, so I'll start a conversation with them. So I suppose that's why I think I'm extroverted. I'm not shy.
Which predominates in you, thinking or feeling?
Feeling. Okay. See, I'm not logical. I'm not claiming to be.
Give us some examples of how you use feeling.
Well, that's tricky. Decision making. We talked about that before. You know, I do use logic when I needed a car. You know, obviously I wanted an economy car, and that was, you know, I wanted good gas mileage, and that was fine. But I found after our conversation the last time how feeling really plays a lot into it, and whether if I'm late or coming home from work, sometimes I'll run into somebody who a good friend of mine, and he was having some problems, so I ended up talking with him one time. Well, several times that's happened to me, and I find myself making decisions by what I think is the greater good, you know. Bob knows this. Whenever we go grocery shopping, you know, there'll be some old person in the vegetable department usually, or the fruit. and they just kind of mosey on over to you, and they'll start saying, they'll say something like, oh, well, those look real ripe, or ooh, those don't look good. And before you know it, there's a conversation started. And before you know it, I'm in a real deep conversation, and Bob's done most of the grocery shopping and come back. And
well, how did they zero in on talking to you? I mean, there's all sorts of people in the store.
Oh, I smile a lot, I think. I know that's true. I do smile a lot. On the Hotshot crew, it was a little different because everybody's was very burly. And trying to prove themselves, you know, who can do the most push-ups, the most pull-ups, who can out-be tougher and rougher than each other. And there was a lot of very macho men that didn't want to talk, or if they did, it was only about, you know, very few subjects that got real boring. How many fires you've been on, you know. You can only hear those things so often, how tough everybody is, and so, you know, I would start talking about their lives, their families, what they did afterwards. And that didn't always work, you know. And sometimes it was a real challenge, and that was fun too, you know. Sometimes getting a smile out of somebody was a real challenge, and that was worth working for, because when you did, it was like finding an Easter egg. It was just it was just neat. Somebody can be very factual. I'm married to somebody who's wins every argument that we get into, because he's just real good. He's very logical thinking. He wins his point, you know. And maybe I know, I know in my heart that it's something else. But it doesn't matter because I can't even begin to argue that point, and I can't verbalize feelings. I mean, they're not something that you can do, and he's going to win every argument because he does. He's
does
very logical.
Make you feel?
it makes me feel a little frustrated, but now that we've been together for so long, what we do now is I don't argue. When I see something coming on, we don't argue. And what we do is I'll talk a little bit of an hour or two later when his emotions are down and my emotions, and I've given a little bit more thought, and then we can talk and be a little bit more flexible, and we've come to work that out. So, but it is frustrating, there's no doubt about it, because it just is.
Do you see places in your life where you would enjoy this thinking
process? Oh yeah. Who wouldn't? Yeah, I do. It's true.
What are some examples where it would help you out to have that?
Organizing my time. Being on time. scheduling myself. Oh, that would be nice. Yeah, I'd say that's one of my biggest. I got a watch for Christmas. And I'm sure that has a little bit to do with how, you know, again, I'm just so, you know, I know I got to do certain things and I got to do time, but I can be sidetracked so easy by other people or feelings or just children or whatever, you know. I mean, there's just little things that sidetrack me, and there I am off schedule. And
or is it that feelings can't be scheduled in the same way?
They can be. I just got to get it together. And I think that's one thing I want to work on is getting that, you know, getting myself so that I can be scheduled and I'll have time limits. And because there's 24 hours in the day, I can accomplish things, you know. I just need to be more organized.
Charles clearly showed his introversion and thinking, while Lee clearly showed her extroversion and feeling. Now, each of us has this well-developed side of ourselves, but we also have a less developed side, which Jung called the inferior function, or the fourth function. Now, in Charles's case, his fourth function is feeling.
If they can't justify their choices in terms of facts, reasons, evidence, their feelings are illegitimate. You know, it's sloppy thinking.
In Lee's case, her fourth function is thinking.
You know, I know I got to do certain things and I got to do time, but I can be sidetracked so easy by other people or feelings or just children or whatever, you know. I mean, there's just little things that sidetrack me, and there I am off schedule. And
doing typological interviews like we did with Charles and Lee are just one way of discovering someone's type. We can also discover their type by seeing the kinds of work they like to do and how they do it. Next, we're going to meet Dee, who is an introverted sensation type and who is an excellent sewer, as we will see. How long have you been making quilts?
Oh, goodness, I guess probably about 40 years, I think.
What got you started in it?
Well, we were living in a place in Colorado that was kind of far up from town, and I had a sewing machine and a box of scraps and a lot of time on my hands, and I just kind of got started. Somehow I wound up with a few patterns, too, and I picked out the simplest one and just went to work. I didn't know what I was doing, but I ended up with some semblance of a quilt. This is a state bird and state flower quilt, and I really loved doing this one. It just, and once I got started, I had it stamped for maybe a year or so before I got started. And once I got started on it, though, I couldn't put it down. I got it all done in one winter. There's 400 hours of embroidery in this quilt. And I prefer embroidery to anything else I do, I think. This pheasant he is particularly difficult. He has a lot of detail.
Where do you get all this patience from, to spend so many hours doing so many little stitches?
It's just something I like to do. You know, someone else will sit and crochet by the hour, which I can kind of do that too. I like that too. Someone else can, like my son is in the telephone business. He matches little tiny wires together all day long, and I would go crazy doing that. And yet it's just more intricate, actually, than this. But I don't know, it's just something I enjoy doing. And to me, it's relaxation. I can sit down home really tired and embroidery and just totally relax with it. It brings me pleasure.
Why?
I don't know, I guess it's just watching the thing develop and grow, because you start out with just a few little lines on a piece of fabric. You get through, you have a realistic looking figure. If you like realism, which I do.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I used my bird book and my flower book to get the right colors on these, because I wanted them to be realistic. And the more real they look, well, the better I like it.
Where do you go in your head when you're doing this? What are you thinking or feeling about when you do it?
Well, usually how the quilt's going to look when I'm through with it. If it's for someone else, I'll be thinking, you know, I wonder how they're going to like it. Or I sure hope they like it. And then I want to do the best job I can do. And
What's that mean?
Well, one thing, some of my bird figures I didn't think looked realistic, and I even changed the shape of the bird according to how they looked in my bird book. And if I'm doing solid, which most of this is, a satin stitch on flower petals, I want it to be real even. And if it doesn't look as even as I want it to, I often will take it back out right then and redo it.
How many stitches are in one of those little flowers?
There's got to be 25 or 30 in just one little petal here. I got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 15 petals.
Now, so you're noticing how even the stitches are in each petal as you put them down?
Yes, and even the little stems, these little lines and everything, you got to put your stitches in just so on those too, to get them nice and even, and so they look
good. Isn't that a bother to get it like that?
Not really, it's a challenge. It's something that, interesting to do. It's, you know, I can do this thing. And if it comes out crooked and I know that's not my best work, I'm just not pleased with it.
And so you'll take it out?
Mm-hmm.
How much detail are you noticing as you do it?
I'm noticing all the details. I mean, there's like this bitterroot, for instance, just happened to be right here in front of me. There's all these little rootlets that show on that thing. And so I want them to look that way. That's how they're supposed to be. I want them to be that way. I look at the toenails and the curve of the bird's feet. And the little tiny feather details. Some feathers are just edged in a little bit of white or lighter color. Just almost a hint of it. And yet, to me, it's important to have those little details in there, because that's what makes that bird look the way it looks. And sometimes they'll have a shadow line, like along the edge of the bill, or kind of a cheek line that's really more of a suggestion than an actual line, and still I want that to be in there and show if I possibly can. And of course I'm working with quite a small detail, so often I will change my thread accordingly. Sometimes I work with just one strand of thread to get the fineness of the detail. And if it's a heavier object, sometimes I go to maybe three strands. Normally I use two for most of the work. And so whatever it requires to bring out the detail I want, then I do that.
It sounds almost like painting.
Yeah, it is. I've often said this is my art. This is my, the needle is my art. And just ordinary embroidery, some people go to needle point, they go to counted cross stitch, and a lot of different things that I just never have gotten into, because I've been happy and satisfied with doing this. It's gratifying to watch it, quote, blossom under my hand as I work.
Do you think people notice the details like you do?
To a point. Sometimes I bring it to their attention. Maybe I'm a little vain. But like on my quail and the pheasant particularly, they have so much detail that I'll sometimes point it out and say, well, you know, I really like this one because it was really difficult. This quail here, you see, has all the little tiny spots. And I put those little tiny details in after I have the rest of the bird done. They're over the top of the other embroidery. Because if I put it right on the fabric, then it becomes lost in the other stitches. And you can't see it.
Do you feel disappointed sometimes when people don't seem to notice how much effort you put into it?
Yes, I do. When I showed this quilt, of course at a distance you couldn't tell, people thought I had appliqued the birds on it. And when I pointed out they were embroidered, then they said, oh my goodness, and they all went over to it and just started looking at it closely, and they couldn't believe the amount of detail and work I had put into it.
How sensitive are you to the shades of color you use?
Very sensitive. I often took my bird book to the store with me to pick out the colors I wanted. So I'd be sure to have just as close to the color it showed as much as the bird book is correct. Sometimes they're not as correct as real life, but that's the closest I could get.
Do you ever feel that since you're spending so much time on your quilts, that you're missing out on something else?
Yes. Yes, in a way I do. I have so many interests, so many things I would like to do that I think, you know, I kind of get, quote, caught up on my quilts sometimes so I can do something else. I would like to paint, and I would like to do more crochet than I do, both with the finer threads and the knit crochet and in yarn, all three, and even maybe rug yarn. I would like to do more in those lines than I'm doing. Not too much into the usual sense of crafts, because I like the things I make to be really useful, and things that are just to sit and look at I'm not too interested in. They're pretty and I like them, but let someone else do those. Now there's a few things I might like to do, like maybe I'd like to carve a duck out of wood. I've always wanted to do that. And there's maybe a few other wood carvings I might like to do if my duck turns out well. Someday I'll get to the duck.
So it's hard to get to these other things.
Yeah, it is, because my time is so taken with quilts. Well, one thing, in my own mind and feelings, I want and in a way have to do quilts for all my close kin. I've done a quilt for each of my sisters and my brother. Each of my kids and grandkids have had their baby quilts as they came along. And then the grandkids are to get their youth quilt as they approach teenage. Plus I'd like to make a quilt for each of my husband's children. So
why do you want to do this?
Well, I just think it's kind of neat for them to say, you know, my mom or my grandma or my stepmom or somebody made that for me, and when I'm gone it'll be something for them to maybe treasure if they, you know, are so inclined. I just think it's a kind of a something nice to for them to have. Something I can do for them that they'll always have there to see and use and know that I cared enough for them to do it. Jim asked me a while ago, you know, what I thought about color, how particular I was about color, and I have all these threads, these different colors of thread, and it seems like every time I go to make something I still have to buy thread because I never have the right color, if you believe that, the right color for what I want. That's how much a stickler I am for color detail.
Thank you, Dee. As you probably noticed, Dee's introverted sensation was connected with a strong second function of feeling. Now we're going to meet Lee, who is an extroverted intuition type with a second function of thinking. Lee works as a sign and rubber stamp maker. And like most jobs, people of many types do it. But Lee's style in doing it will reveal his type. Tell us something about the kind of business you run here.
Okay, basically what I started out doing rubber stamps, but now, and it was the old types setting method with the cold metal type, but I saw what kind of a market there was, so I went out and I purchased some sophisticated equipment where I can get a black and white through a typesetter, and I can turn it into any kind of rubber stamp, any size I want with my camera or my typesetter. I can do logos, signatures. In a matter of a couple hours, I can turn stamps that used to take maybe 7 to 10 days to get a mold into something in 2-3 hours. And additionally, this last year, I added a computerized engraving system. And the computerized engraving really means not much to too many people. But what it does, it gives you the versatility to be able to vary your letters one letter style alone, you can vary it so many unlimited different ways. You can go the height, you can change to a tenth of a point, etc. You can italicize, reverse the letters and things, and it means so much more to the customer because you can bring the price down, you can deliver the volume in 10 times faster.
How did you learn to operate all this fancy equipment?
Well, I've always been one to, if something's being done, I see something throughout the United States or wherever, or when I was in the Air Force, somebody was doing it. If I didn't know anything about it, I started checking trade journals, library, asking questions of business people that might be in the industry, and then I just started checking on my own, and that's how I found out. I knew nothing about how to get the typesetter, didn't even know what it was until I went out and found out how people did it, and got a hold of the right company, and first thing you know, I had some equipment sitting here.
You can find the state-of-the-art equipment by researching it.
Yes, it's just a matter of, if you need something, just go out and look for it. If that doesn't work, then you find somebody that's got some knowledge and tell them what you want developed. That's basically the way I do things. It's my philosophy. If you want to do something, just don't let anything stop you. Just go ahead and try to do it.
In a normal business, how many people would be required to do what you're doing alone now?
The ultimate would be the volume I'm doing right now, probably three or four. My problem is I can't seem to get organized because of the amount of planning. Basically what I'm doing is I'm a technician now, and I should be a business person. That's what it amounts to. I'm not really running the business. I'm trying to do the technical end of it, the business end of it. I can't really do any planning. I do it all in my head. I don't have any time to really write anything down like I should, so I can cut out some of the loopholes and things. But like I say, it would probably take four to half a dozen people to run it properly. To do the same amount of work I'm doing now, probably I'd say two, because I spend 18, 20 hours a day, usually 6-7 days a week.
If you had people to mind the shop, what part of the business would you enjoy doing most?
Well, I would enjoy discussing with professional people such as engineers and architects, bankers, heads of our purchasing agents, the people that actually, where I could zero in on volume things and where I could set up systems in complete businesses. I don't like to do ones and twos jobs. I like to set up complete systems, and what this does, it gives me ongoing business in the future.
When you're working so many hours, how can you sustain such a schedule?
Well, it's always been my opinion that if you're busy, you're going to be healthier, especially doing something that you really enjoy doing. And the thing with my job is there's so much variety. There's always something new every day. If there isn't something new, I create something new. And that I guess that's what sustains me. It's not only my occupation, it's also my hobby.
You obviously don't have any trouble coming up with new ideas.
No, it's in fact, I get so many ideas sometimes I wish I could just get them out of my mind. It kind of boggles my mind that I don't have the time to sit down and plan like I want and get the proper technical work, such as I could even go through the college and use the advantage of the school to help me develop things.
What part of the business do you like the least?
The part of the business I like least, I suppose, is not being able to keep a commitment at a specific time and date, such as I tell a customer that I want to get something done. I guess it's because I don't have the help. That's probably the part I like the least. But as far as anything I actually do, there's not much of my business that I don't like. If I don't like something, then I can't really sell it. I can't convince somebody else, so I just get rid of it. Such as hot stamping. I used to be into that, and it takes so much time. So I just kind of got away from that and just told people that if they want anything like that, they'd have to deal in volume, and I could farm the work out.
Some people are present-oriented and enjoy the present moment and details, and other people are future-oriented and enjoy sniffing out new possibilities. Which is stronger in you?
And although I am continually looking towards the future, I keep telling my wife that I've got so many things to do that I wish I could live three or four lifetimes. I would like to be a lawyer, doctor. There's just so many things that's in this life that a person can take any one facet of any one of those professions and just have a tremendous life. Say my mind is click, 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 click all this time, and that's true. I wish I could live 3 or 4 lifetimes. I really do.
How fast does your mind go? That's what intrigues me. How do you keep track of so many ideas?
When I'm sitting watching television, say a junk show, a murder show, anything, my mind is still clicking all the time, and I'm trying to file and organize all this. If I could remember everything like I can remember numbers, I could go into business just selling my memory. But like I say, I'm always thinking all the time, even when I'm laying in bed. And it's not that I'm a nervous person, it's just that I enjoy life so much. It's just that there's so many things to do that I want to get into. I would like to just spend my time, if nothing else, studying about bees, find out why a bee will go to one hive that's marked completely different than all the rest. These kind of things, it just fascinates me. Well, I guess one of my philosophies has always been, and it's probably been a lot of other people know, is I don't like for anybody to tell me that you can't do something, because to me that only indicates a degree of difficulty. I mean, it maybe it's possible. I can't fly, but don't tell me I can't, because there's a chance I'll try to figure out a way to do it. Right. It's just not that I want to, not that I'm stubborn or got so much pride. It's just that I just despise hearing somebody say, I can't do this, or I don't have the time to do it. If you really want something bad enough, you just go ahead and do it. Because it's not getting it done, it's the joy of trying to do it.
Thanks, Lee. Now, in D and Lee, we saw the contrast between the realism of sensation and how it's attached to the present moment, and the future orientation of intuition. D is caught up in the present moment, so she doesn't have the time she would like for new projects.
I have so many interests, so many things I would like to do, that I think, you know, I kind of get, quote, caught up on my quilt sometimes, so I can do something else.
Lee, in contrast, is caught up in so many new ideas, it's hard for him to be pinned down to the present moment.
The part of the business I like least, I suppose, is not being able to keep a commitment at a specific time and date.
We've seen thinking, feeling, sensation, and intuition. And now we're going to see them again with the attitude, that is, the introversion or extroversion, reversed. First, we're going to look at an extroverted thinking type. Herb has spent his life as a mechanic and log truck driver, and he has a remarkable ability to meet problems head on. Now, if we listen carefully, a person's type can be discovered in the kind of stories they tell. One snowy winter day, Herb was hauling a load of lumber over the Cascade Mountains in Oregon. The road to the pass was closed, but Herb kept on going.
We slid off on the inside of the turn, so that made us be in the wrong lane. And we knew it was closed, so there was no traffic. I didn't expect to be any traffic on it, of course. We had gone ends as far as we could. Even with chains, we couldn't pull it any longer, so it was just a matter of when we got stuck and where we got stuck. That was the end of the run. A little while, we saw lights coming down the mountain, down the highway, and I could tell right away that by the snow boiling up in front of it was a snow plow, and we're in the wrong lane, and he didn't see us until he was real close. So he cut it to the left and crossed the other lane and ran right out into space. Straight down for I don't know how far. And just as he went over the bank, I told Rollin, let's get the first aid kit and a fire extinguisher and go down there and see if we can help him. So we were standing there looking down into this canyon, and we saw that truck standing right on its blade down there up against a tree, and the light's still on. And just about then we saw something moving in the snow off to the left of where I was standing, and looked up, and there's a guy come crawling out of the snow. He said, boy, that was close. I said, man, you're lucky. You got out of there just in time. He got us started, and we got over the top finally about 4 o'clock in the morning. Went down to the first coffee shop, and these guys, the state guys, all in there drinking coffee and commenting about that guy that they went by the sign. They had trouble with him all night trying to get him over the hill, and one of them was getting pretty threatening. And I thought, "Hey, guys, you're talking about me. I made it. Aren't you happy?" Boy, he said, "You could have gone to jail for that trick." I said, "Yeah, but I didn't. Let's go, Rollins." So down the road we went.
And why did you go by the sign to begin with?
We had to get home.
Didn't you work as a deputy sheriff out in Bly once?
Bonanza, yeah.
Bonanza?
Yeah.
What was that like?
Oh, that's terrible. Only had to be on 3 days a week actively downtown Bonanza. And that time was around beer joints, keeping the chasing the troublemakers out of town or putting them in jail, whichever they preferred. Most of it was pretty regular stuff, no excitement. I just gave them an ultimatum, either leave town or go to jail. And some guy says, "You can't put me in jail," so I just made sure I put him in jail. I grabbed him with the iron claw and stood him up on his head and then put the handcuffs on him and pulled him off to jail. And that kind of set an example. They said, "Don't mess around out there because that guy will put you in jail."
Well, what's the iron claw?
Well, it looks like a half a handcuff, one half of a handcuff. And it opens up like this. Got a stem on it and a T-handle here. You open this up and reach out and grab them like that. You trip that. Then you hang right on that T-handle and start tightening it up, and you put a lot of pressure on it. And one guy I caught by the neck with it. Of course, it's a good thing I did, too, because he had a gun right there. I was lucky I didn't get shot in that deal.
Well, what was he doing?
Well, he'd chopped his common law wife up with an axe and chopped the hole in her back. They came over to my place and got me and told me that is reported it. I went to where she was supposedly went after this assault and looked it over, and they could see her backbone and her spine. Hey, you little squirts. And so the first duty is to take her that is medical attention is the first thing you do. So I took her to Klamath to the hospital. Then I went back out to Bonanza and to arrest this guy that assaulted her. I went up to the front door, and old lady Jackson said, told me, "Be quiet." She says, "He's in this bedroom over here, and he's got a rifle. So you be careful," she says. Told me to come around the back door. She's just whispering to me. So I went around the back door and slipped in, and she showed me a bedroom that opened into the bedroom that he was sitting in. He was sitting over. I could see him looking through those two doorways. I could see him sitting there on the edge of the bed, and he had a 30-30 in the corner at where he could reach it. So I thought, well, I either got to give it up or go get him, one or the other. If I can sneak up on him from behind, I can nail him before he gets hold of that gun. So I took my boots off and so I could walk quietly and sneaked a step at a time. I got my iron claw. I planned to just reach across the bed and grab him by the neck. Got my iron claw all ready and slipped up to him and reached across the bed and grabbed him by the neck and Of course, he just let out a scream and jumped up, and I just twisted the claw up and like that, and he came down on his head. Then I had him under control. So I put the handcuffs on him and started him off, haul him off to jail. That is, I started to jail with him, and I didn't cuff him with his hands behind him. And he reached over and flipped the door handle and jumped out. And so I ran him down and lugged him back in there, and that time I took a rope and tied him in. And he whopped me on the side of the head with the handcuffs a couple of times, with his fists and the handcuffs. And I finally wrestled him to jail. Well, he got wild just before we got to the jail again the last time, and so I just pulled him out of the car and walked him the rest of the way to jail, because I couldn't keep him off of me while I was trying to drive. It was about 10 below zero, and there was no fire in the jail. There was nobody in there, and there was no fire there, so I thought this would cool him off. He'd been drinking pretty heavy. He was drunk, but not staggering drunk. Just mean drunk. So I put him in the cell and told him I'd had to go call it. When I went back and started the fire, he was plumb sober by that time. He was pretty cold. He was laying on the floor with the mattress on top of him, on a concrete floor. So I fired up the little oil stove and got him comfortable and went. And about that time, the Marshal came out and hauled him off.
Thank you, Herb. Next, we're going to meet my daughter, Elizabeth. She's a introverted feeling type with a second function of sensation. Liz, tell us whether you're more introverted or extroverted.
I'm more introverted. Because I'm like a cat, I like to curl up in the corner and read a book. And I only can visit with people for a while, and then I have to go away. I like being alone. Well, when I meet new people, I tend to be shy for like a day or so until I get to know them and see if they like me and if I like them. And then I'm not shy around them after a day or so. Well, when I'm in crowds, I just keep to myself. And then if there's a few people that I know, then I'll talk to them. But other than that, I won't, you know, go around to everyone and say hi. Okay, when I go to work for like a day, it takes like 3 days until I'm really tired. And then I go and have to be alone in my room. And then I take another 3 days of being a total extrovert. And then take time by myself, and then I just crash. I'm just like totally quiet at all times.
Which is stronger in you, feeling or thinking?
Feeling is stronger in me because I don't use logic. I use my heart instead of my head. Well, when I meet someone, the first thing I notice is their smile and the way they react to me as a person, and then I notice all their details, of their hair, their face, their clothes, whatever. And if they are responding well to me, and then I'll respond well to them. But if they kind of act like they don't like me, then I don't respond to them at all. With most people, I have no problem showing my feelings toward them, but when it comes to guys that I like, then that comes to a problem, because even though I may like them a lot, I don't show it very well, you know. If they come sit next to me, then I kind of like edge away, like I don't really want to have anything to do with them. And if they smile, I'll smile, but, you know, I'll just, I won't be that nice about it. I kind of think that I'm not that friendly around guys that I really like. Kids are no problem. I can open up totally to them because they don't have too many bad things to say about you. And even if it is, it's so minor that it doesn't even matter. you can talk to them and crawl around on the floor with them, and they won't go, "Ew, what are you doing?" So they're fine. The same with animals. They can't say anything. My feelings tend to store up since I'm an introverted feeler, and the way I get them out the most, the best way I find that helps, is I write a lot, short stories and songs and stuff, and I store up a bunch of feelings and I get it out by writing. But when I don't write that much, I have to get it out in other ways, like screaming at my brother. Well, I listen to music a lot because, I don't know, I have to have noise around me constantly. And another reason is if I feel down, then I play high music so I can feel better. And if I feel really happy, then I play depressing music. I spend a lot of energy trying to please people. Like, say, I know they really would like me to do something, whatever it is, and I don't feel like I really want to do it, but I want to do it to make them happy, not myself.
Which is stronger in you, sensation or intuition?
Sensation is stronger in me because if I walk in a room, I notice everything, especially if it's totally new to me. If I'm around it all the time, then I don't really notice as much as if it's brand new. But sensation is the strongest in me because I'm totally neat. If anything's messed up, it kind of drives me up the wall. Any detail that is around me, I notice. Like I said, if it's new to me. If I've been around it a few years, then I just take it for granted. When I meet someone for the first time, I notice their hair, the way it's curled, or if it's not curled, the way it's styled. And I think about how much time they spent, and if their color, their hair is natural or not, and their face, their eyes, and where they got their eyes from, their mom or the dad. And the lips and stuff, and I look at their clothes and wonder where they shop and how much time they took and how much money they spent on their clothes. It only takes a few minutes to assess every part of them. Doesn't take long at all. Well, everything I see, I have a certain feeling for. As say, I see color yellow. It depends on the yellow, but most of the time I'm like, ooh, that's pretty. But if it's like a mustard color, I'm like, oh, barf, you know? It depends on the color if I like it or not. Everything I see, I have an opinion on it. Say I see a nice house that I really like, and I like everything about it. Well, at first I say, wow, I really like this. And then I get ideas of how I want my house to be. And I get all these little feelings and details of how I want my house in the future. So everything I see every day, I might get a little piece that goes into the puzzle of what I want my place and what I want myself to be later on in the future. Okay. The way I show intuition is when I'm like planning projects and I make a long list of all the projects I want to do, say, in a day. It never works out, of course, because I'm just a tootie, like mad. And I only get maybe one project done. That's where that comes from. I'm present oriented, and I like the past as well, but future I can't even see. People who are intuitors get on my nerves sometimes because they have all these projects and they seem so unrealistic. And I'm the type who have their feet on the ground and think about what's to be done today. The intuitors rush on and say, well, I'm going to do this and this and this, and it's months away that they're planning to do this. And I'm like, yeah, get real. I mean, these guys never carry through. All talk and never do. That's what I say. My least developed function is thinking, simply because I don't use any logic whatsoever. Well, the way I make decisions is I use my heart, not my head. It's instinct, whether I feel good about doing something or not. If I don't feel good about it, then I'll make a scene. But the problem with that is people like, well, that's dumb, that's not logical, why? They ask why, and I can't really answer very well.
Liz, could you show us one of your pictures and read us one of your poems?
Okay, this is one of my poems I've written in the past. It's called Poem of the Dream. You came to me in my dreams last night, hands full of tropical flowers and the sun's delight. You touched my cheek as if to say you miss me, but then you slowly faded away. You came to me in the shadows of my soul. You bring me presents of rubies and of gold. You touch my hand as if to say you need me, but then you slowly fade away. And you speak to me with your dark eyes, and you kiss me with lips that tell no lies. Then you give me back my world, and then you slowly fade away.
Thanks, Liz. Now, in Elizabeth, the first function of feeling is closely bound with the second function of sensation. And that's true of just about all of us. The first two functions work together with the second function helping the primary function, but they're intermingled. So if we were to go and find an introverted feeling type with a second function of intuition, it would look different from what we saw with Elizabeth. The same with every other type. So we could have interviews with, instead of 8 types, with 16 different types. But enough is enough. Next, we're going to meet my Aunt Pat. She's an extroverted sensation type with a second function of feeling, and she's the mother of 6 children. Do you like colors?
Oh yeah, I love colors. I think colors is what make people tick. You know, like Pat likes red. You know, he's always in a rush, and he's always, you know, bopping around. That's red. But I like yellow, orange, the blues.
And
like
what's
green.
Yellow and orange?
Happy, sun, bright, you know. And blue and greens, they're like peaceful, like the water and the sky. That's how I relate to colors.
Now,
I don't like black and white. Kelly can tell you that. I think people that wear black and white have no enthusiasm. They're all, you know, drab people. I like colors. Hmm. Although I'm wearing a black shirt, though. That's silly, right? That's silly. Like, I like the smell of my dogs after I give them a bath. Smell of an orange, that's nice. It's got a nice smell. I like smells. Smell of like meat cooking, corned beef, smell of popcorn. I don't like to eat popcorn, but I like the smell of popcorn. Stuff like that. It makes you, like, popcorn makes you feel like it's a homey place, you know.
If you were to walk into a house for the first time, what would you notice?
The plants. That would be the first thing.
What would you notice about them?
That they were green, they were growing pretty, the size of them. Like how they stand up, are they being taken care of? Like one looks pretty droopy right now. And then the pictures, like how it, you know, like that affects like the mood of the person, I think, when you walk into a room. It tells you a lot about a person, like what they like, what they don't like. I think I would notice the pictures, the accessories of the room. Not so much the furniture, the things that are in the room. Like a lot of people like sports activities, you'd notice that in the room. So I would notice the pictures, the details of the person. I feel the details of a person's life is in a room. You
know? Explain that to me.
Like I said, if you go into my son's house, you'd walk into the room, you'd know right away he's a fireman. There's statues around of a fireman. I think that's it. Like the pictures that are around, like if like a lot of pictures, that means that the person is family oriented, wants their family around them a lot, so the pictures are around. Like in your mom's house, there's all pictures around, so you know she's family oriented. Some houses you go in and there's not a picture of, I've noticed you go in a person's house and there's not a picture of anyone around. And I always think, that's odd, isn't, you know, they don't care enough about people to have a picture around of them. And if there's like pictures on the walls of animals, they're usually animal lovers. And that's how you can tell what a person's lifestyle is, I think, by what the accessories in the room, not so much the size of the room or how it's curtains or stuff like, maybe even curtains. I can notice in my house, most of the curtains are cafe curtains because I like the sun in the room. So that tells you, you know, an outdoor person that likes fresh air and stuff. I think people, I find like a lot of my girlfriends that you walk into the house and there's drapes and curtains. They're people who sit and watch television all day long. So they don't let the sun into the house because they want to watch TV. I think that tells you a lot about a person. That person's not an outdoor person. Don't want to sit outside, would rather be in the house. And that's a waste to me. I guess what I would notice, if it's a homely house, like can you sit in the living room, can you have a soda, or is it the type where it's like a playhouse where, you know, you can't put a glass down. Like my mother-in-law was like that. You can't sit in the living room, you can't put a glass down, and that's not a home to me. A home is like if you want to have a messy bedroom, well, that's your lifestyle. As long as it's clean, but it's messy, okay. Yeah.
Do you have a problem meeting new people?
No, I like to meet new people. I guess I'm kind of those people, I like to draw out of them things about them. I like to get to know new people. I'm curious about people. I like, maybe that's a fault. I ask a lot of questions when, like, if I go in a new situation among new people, I'll ask questions about them, you know, how many kids they have or what do they do for a living. I like to meet new people. I think it's fun to meet new people. You know, like to learn, I don't know, just to, I think every day is a learning experience, no matter how old you are. So I think to know people, whether they're prejudiced or they're not prejudiced, and I don't, I meet them for what they are. I just think that people should try to be nice to each other. They shouldn't hurt each other's feelings. If something happens and people apologize to you for it, you should accept their apology and not not gloat on the fact that, you know, they did something to me. Or, you know, if a person sincerely apologizes to you, take the apology and try to make the best of a situation. I think that people shouldn't argue, they shouldn't cause friction in a family, or try to make the best of a situation. Everybody doesn't have to like everyone. I'm not saying that. There's certain people that I don't like. But I've always had the way of dealing with it, and I've tried to teach my kids, is that mentally you take a picture of the things that the people do that are good. And then on the other hand, you take a list of the things that people do bad. And you outweigh them. And if you have a person that basically does good things, so you try to, you know, do away with bad things and like them for the things you know they do. I mean, there's a few people that really I could do without seeing all the time, but when I see them, I'm pleasant to them because I want to be pleasant to people. And because they act bad doesn't mean that I'm going to be the same as them. Like, my outlook is always try to be a peacemaker, to try to keep people, she's going to rap on me, to try to keep people happy, like in a family unit. I don't think that there should be discord in a family unit. If you don't like one brother or something, keep your mouth shut and you know, live with it. In other words, live with it. This is life, make the best of it, and don't argue and don't fight. You know, I relate to people, I think, fairly good. Kids especially. Oh, I think they're honest with you. If they like you, they like you. If they don't like you, they don't like you. I don't know. Kids are more fun, they have better personalities. I find out when you get to be adults, you get to be more cynical about life, and I don't know, life's too short to be like that. You think the best of everybody, and I find, I don't think there's no such thing as a bad kid. I like all kids. I don't appreciate them if they have bad mouths. That's one thing that turns me off on kids. But adults, I don't like to deal with adults because, as I said, I think they're too, how can I put it? I don't know. Like, I think adults are not honest in life. You know, they don't get a, I don't think adults basically get along with each other. I think they're in competition with each other. And I don't like that in people. I think people should get along and everybody try to be nice and don't hurt people's feelings. I know it's like a fairy way of telling, thinking, but as I said, life is too short. Try to be nice to everybody. And I think kids are like that. I know they can be mean among themselves sometimes, but as an adult, I enjoy kids more than I will people. Like if I have to work in school, if I have a choice, I'd rather work with the kids than with the adult committees. Because I think you're, I think you're trying to make a kids better, that they'll be better adults if you treat them, you know, like people. And say, you know how some people take kids and like put them in a corner and don't have them have a voice, you know, that you have to treat kids like people, not just like little kids. And that's what I like to do. I like to treat kids like people and have fun with them and, you know, try to be their friend and try to guide them to be better adults, that they won't be like catty people or, you know, two-faced. I don't like two-faced people. When I'm away from the house, the kids in the neighborhood don't come around. She gets annoyed because I can sit on that stoop for like 10 minutes and I have like all the kids in the neighborhood around the stoop, from the little bitty ones to the teenagers, because I kid around with them and I, you know, I kind of like to hang out with kids. That seems silly, but that's the truth. I like to hang out with kids. The younger ones, the little boy across the street, everybody on the block thinks he's a little troublemaker, you know, like a tough little kid. He's going into kindergarten. He's adorable. I think he's adorable. I mean, he needs some discipline every now and then, but he's a cute kid. As I said, I relate to kids. I like kids. Even if they're got things wrong with them, I can still pick out the good things in a kid. Like this one kid up the block is very hypo, giving his parents a big trouble, but I find things in that kid that I like. I would like to have that kid for about a month, and I change that kid, you know.
If someone was going to punish you and gave you a choice between being in a room with a lot of people who were going to be up talking and singing for 16 or 20 hours a day, or being in absolute solitude where you didn't have any contact with people, what would be the biggest punishment?
Being in solitude, that would be the biggest punishment.
Why?
Why? That's a hard question. Why? Gosh, I don't know. That's a hard one to answer. Well, I guess because I like people. I wouldn't want to be away from people forever. I mean, there's times when I like to be in a nice, quiet room. Like, I like this room, and if I have a bad day, I like to sit in this room and look at the skies at night, because everyone in the house hollers that I sit with the shades open at night, because I like to see the planes go by and the sky and stuff. Oh, God, I couldn't be in, like, solitude. I think it would make you, you'd probably start looking into yourself and finding things that you don't like about yourself if you had to deal with yourself, like, if you had to deal with yourself, like, 48 hours in a black room or a solitude room. No. I think that must be the hardest thing for people if they go to prison, if they get put in solitary confinement, to have to live with yourself, like, day after day.
As opposed to
being with a group of people. Because I could handle this one's personality, that one's personality. But I don't think I could handle my own personality for 48 hours or something like that. I might find things wrong with me that I wouldn't like or something. That's a bad question. I don't like that question. That's the first one I found I didn't like. Yeah.
Thanks, Pat. Next, we're going to meet my son, John, who is an introverted intuition type with a second function of thinking. Are you an introvert or an extrovert?
Okay, I'd say the real difference between me and a so-called true extrovert is, yeah, sure, I'll go out in the front row of Petra, and I'll go, yes, you know, and then I'll just be rocking out. I'll be the most rocking out person there. I'll go up to people and say, hey, dude, how's it going? You know, and people say, whoa, this kid is so extrovert. What they don't know is I come home, I say, hi, Mom, I say, hi, Dad, boom. You know, I'm dead, you know? I'm like, I will pass out for like 96 hours in a row, and I'll wake up and I'll just have to pry my eyelid open and I'll say, whoa, you know, morning everybody, you know, I think I'll go right back to sleep, you know. That's where I pay, you know. I'm just like, you know, I'm dead, you know. And I've seen two extroverts, they will get up, they'll party just like me, they'll stay up just as late, and the next morning they're up, they're ready to go, and they want to party more. And I'm like, no, it's time to sleep, you know, it's time to die, you know, I'm a zombie.
Which is stronger in you, intuition or sensation?
Well, I'd have to say intuition, because whenever somebody asks me to remember, like, the color of their clothes, you know, what shirt I'm wearing today, whether I have my glasses on or a watch, you know, where I put something, that's a total blank to me, you know. And people will talk about a person we just met and they say, well, you know, that guy had gorgeous blue eyes. And I'm like, okay, he had blue eyes. I'll take your word for it, you know. Details like that totally go over my head.
How does your intuition show itself?
I'd say the clearest example is I see like a, usually it's like a 4x4 or a car going down the street. And it's just like the piece of junk, you know. It's like totally rusted, it's gray colored, the tires and wheels are like, you know. And I say, whoa, I mean, that thing can be the most awesome car in Klamath Falls if, and then, you know, if a paint job, and I'll do this to it, and I'll modify the fenders, I'll put on these new tires and mags, and I'll drop a 351 Cleveland nitrous oxide. And then I don't even stop to think, it would be much easier to go out and buy a brand new rig than to, but all I see, and then pretty soon I'm not even looking at the car anymore. I'm seeing what it can be. I'm not seeing whether this is really, you know, really just a piece of junk that's not even worth doing anything with. I just see what it's going to be.
Do you follow through on intuition?
That is a big problem. I'll say bodybuilding, for example. I'll make a list of about 50 things wrong. I'll have 50, you know, how to do each and every exercise, how to eat and everything. And I'll be real energetic for the first 15 minutes. The only problem is when it comes time to do the second workout, it just doesn't happen, you know. I'm off, you know, I'm gone.
How many new ideas do you get during the course of a day?
I can't count that high. I mean, by the time I reach the end of the day, I've already, you know, I've done so many things I can't even remember what I was doing in the beginning of the day. I wake up in the morning. As I reach over to get the book I'm supposed to study, I'll look at a four-wheeler magazine. I'll just see the cover, and I'll say, hey, you know, someday I'm going to be a para, you know, I'll start off with one idea, and one idea triggers another idea. Someday I'm going to own a 4x4, you know, it's going to be a jacked up Toyota 4x4. Then I'm going to be a paramedic, and, you know, to make the money to get the 4x4. Nah, not paramedics, it's not exciting enough. I'm going to join the LA SWAT team. Oh yeah, by the way, I'm going to be taking Taekwondo, you know, and then, by the way, I'm going to start working out, you know, and then I'm going to buy these guns, and, oh yeah, and I'm going to live in this house. And pretty soon, I'm sitting there on my bed, 3 hours have gone by, the book is opened, and laid on the bed next to me, and I'm like, John, what are you doing, you know? I've just gone through my whole life story, and I haven't even opened my book. It's almost lunchtime and time to do a report. And those 3 hours are, like, gone. Poof! You know, and I'm like, whoa, you know, get your act together. So it's like, you know, if I had spent the amount of time actually working that I talk about, you know, the time I think about dreaming, I mean, I'd probably be the richest person around here, because 24 hours a day, you know. Even when I'm studying a book, you know, I'm just constantly, you know. They can say one word, they can say radioactive waste, and I'm gone, and pretty soon, I'm thinking about how I'm going to colonize Mars or something. You know, one thing leads to the next, and it's like an ongoing thing. It never stops.
How does thinking show itself?
At first, I'm real intuitive, and then I'll picture my fantasy 4x4, and all jacked up, and all the potentials, and all the things I'll do with it, all the fun I'll have, and then I'll stop, and I'll just take it apart in my mind, just piece by piece, just bolt by bolt, until I'm just got everything down into tiny little parts, and then I'll polish each and every part, and I'll perfect it in my mind, and I'll put it back together and build it until I have perfection.
What about actually working on cars? Do you work on cars?
Oh, please. Cars are my worst nightmare. I love dreaming about them, but it put me under there, and then I'm like, I'm okay for the first 5 seconds, and the oil starts dripping in my face, I rip my fingernails, I'm like, ah, boom, you know, I cannot stand this. I'm like, please, just give me a job, I'll work anything, I'll work at anything but actually on cars to get the money to buy cars, because I'm like the worst person in the world when it comes to working on cars.
What about your feelings?
My feelings are like, you know, so intense that I lock up on them. Like, if somebody will say something to me, like hurt my feelings, my immediate reaction is to just either cuss them out or just turn away and just, you know, they'll never know. You know, I'll say, it's kind of like a mental thing. If they hurt me, well, I'm not going to let them know that they actually got to me, you know. I won't show them that I've been in pain. I'll just, and then later if they come to me and say, hey, what's wrong, then I'll tell them, you know, but they have to initiate it. I'm not going to ever, you know, show them that they hurt me.
Can you bring out your feelings and use them to relate to people?
I can't control it, you know. Well, that's not quite true. But a lot of times, all of a sudden, gosh, you know, all of a sudden I have feelings, you know, for a while. And then, I mean, it's not that I don't have feelings all the time, it's just they're not right here, you know. I can't deal with them. And then a lot of times, I'll have my feelings come up, and then people think I'm just a normal John, and they don't know, hey, this is feeling John. And I'll reach out and I'll try to touch people, and they're so used to my, you know, my constant jive or whatever, is they'll just treat me normal, and that really hurts, you know. And I'll just say, hey, there's no way I can say, hey, you know, this is not the normal me, this is me with the extra feelings, you know. And then I'll just reach out and I'll just smile at people, and they'll just go, eh, you know, because they're used to me, you know, normal me, which I would care less whether someone smiled at me or not. And then that hurts, and then my feelings disappear. But there are times where they just come out, you know, it's just, you know, and it blows me off my feet, and I start crying, and, you know, everything else. That's rare, but it has happened, you know. And I find that I can bring them out if I work on it. I just say, hey, whoa, don't jump on people, you know, don't verbally attack them all the time. Just like relax, and then when I try to restrain my thinking and, you know, intuition, then my feelings have a chance to come out and relate, you know. But it's real pain to try to, you know, restrain myself.
What are some of the things you can think of that would help you to be more balanced?
If I told you everything I thought I had to do to become more balanced, you'd be sitting here for the rest of your life. But I'd say one is discipline. You know, if I have discipline, I can basically work on every other problem I have, you know. And another is feelings. You know, I guess I really come on, you know, a little too strong, you know. I really, you know, sometimes I chop on people, when I really should just say, hey, you know, that's okay. Give them a sweet smile, give them a hug, and say, hey, I know you have problems, you know, but I'll stand by. But instead, I just say, hey, well, here's what you should do about it, and I'll give them all the reasons why and everything else, and they're just like, whoa, you know, I really can handle my own life, thank you, you know. So I'd say discipline, and then not being a more caring person, because I'm a really caring person, but showing that I'm a caring person.
Give me an example of when you do have sensation at your disposal.
I do have sensation when it comes to what I want. If whatever I'm working on is important to me, in an intuition or thinking wise, then my sensation comes into play. Like, for example, I was into ring casting once, you know. I'd cast these rings, and I would spend hours cleaning them off with a file and polishing them. You know, that's all detail work. But it was because I was focusing. I don't have, like, an unlimited range of sensation. I have sensation for, like, one item. I have to select it out, and I have to block out everything else and focus in. A lot of people can just walk down the street and go, whoa, you know, I see all the colors and everything. I can pick one thing out and say, yes, that item was pink. You know, I'm sure of that, you know. But they can do the same thing with thousands of items.
Thanks, John. Now that we've seen the eight types, we're in a better position to understand some of the features of Jung's typology. The differences that Jung described are deeply rooted differences. I think we're all born with them, and they embrace our bodies and biochemical makeup as well. We have to learn to see types. Theory is not enough. Sometimes I can recognize a person's type after I've known them for a few minutes. Other times, it literally takes years. All of us have a well-developed side and a fourth or inferior function. And if we can accept the fact that these differences exist, we have a superb tool for understanding the people around us and developing tolerance. What we have been seeing in terms of the eight types and type recognition is just the beginning of typology. Let's get a sense of what typology is like in action by meeting my married friends, Roy and Ellen. Roy is a log truck driver and is an introverted thinking type, and Ellen is a clothes designer and is an extroverted feeling type. This makes them a marriage of opposites. Roy, how does your introversion show itself?
I think that I can take things in better than letting them go out, I guess, because I don't feel that I'm as outgoing as other people around me as far as expression and dealing with other people. I don't think that I need people around me as much as a lot of people do, or most people, I would say. And I can sit and read for days. And I guess I value my own opinion more than somebody else's.
Ellen, how does your extroversion show itself?
Well, I like to do things around other people. I like to teach people how to do things. I like to involve other people in my life. I like to be out there in the front. I mean, I like to be the center of attention. I'm a performer, you know, and I like to be watched, and I like to be looked at rather than have me look at other people. I would rather be looked at.
Roy, how do you feel that you're different from Ellen, and how does that affect you?
There were times in my life where I was pretty much in the center of attention and stuff, and I guess I enjoyed it, but I don't know, I feel people change, and I definitely have changed the other way. I would much rather that camera was on her than me. And I would rather somebody else was out front there saying, hey, look at me. So I'm glad, you know, if she can let me be inside and she'd go out there and have a good time, we'll, you know, as long as you don't involve me, I'm really happy.
Roy, what is stronger in you, sensation or intuition?
The one I think is stronger would probably be the intuitive side, but I think it might be about like 60-40.
Okay.
It's I like to look ahead and I like to plan ahead, and I want to be able to retire in comfort, and I want to be able to look down the road and say at least I'm heading towards a certain goal, very much. And at the same time, I'm obviously married to a wife who is very much a sensator. So, so apparently, I like that too. And I do enjoy the mountains. I can look out there, and this is my favorite view is right here. So, and as far as the senses go, I think I like food, and I don't like cigarettes. And, I like to look at art and things, so I don't know what to say besides I think it's more intuitive, but 60-40.
Okay, what about you, Ellen? Which do you think is stronger in you?
I misunderstood the word intuitor before, because for some reason I was thinking intuition meant more on a kind of a spiritual level. And as far as on a spiritual level, I think I am very intuitive. But on a day-to-day level, I think I am definitely a sensator, because I really get into the moment of things, and if my emotions or whatever is in that moment, it's very important what's in that moment to me. And I'm not necessarily thinking about what it's going to be like tomorrow. So I think probably I'm more of a sensator. But I think I also have a lot of intuitive parts of me too.
Okay. Ellen, which is stronger, thinking or feeling?
I understand the difference between emotion and feeling, but I definitely feel things. And I think the feeling to me is more of a kind of a spiritual feeling. I think it's aligned with God, and my feelings about God or my feelings, I don't know, there's like a soul feeling that goes into if I meet a person, I have a feeling about them when I meet them, whether they're good or bad person, or whether they would be good for me or bad for me. And or just a feeling about a situation. And I tend to go towards that, and I sometimes feel like I should rely more on my logic in a lot of situations, but I don't, and it's very difficult for me to plan things. Because I don't know, I have a hard time sitting down and logically thinking out a plan for an activity or something. And instead, I'll just go in and do it, and get it done and work it out however it works out.
Roy, as a primary thinker, how would you describe your feeling function?
I think that a lot of times I try not to express my feelings because they're a little bit strong sometimes, and so I try and control my feelings more than Ellen does, say. Ellen can let fly, and that's Ellen, and I have to watch myself more than that. I can't absolutely let fly. As far as actual emotions go, how do you say? You don't, I guess you can't judge them right or wrong, or more right than yours, or, whatever. It is the intensity you can judge, I guess, by what comes out. But even if it doesn't come out, it doesn't mean that there is not one heck of a lot of intense feelings there. And very strong feelings, opinions. This is the way it is, and damned if it isn't.
Roy, as a logger driving a truck 6 or 7 days a week and usually more than 400 miles a day, what do you think about?
Family, a lot, and money, and paying attention to my job. It's a serious job. It's mostly mental because you don't want to die, and it's a dangerous job. It's a dangerous occupation, so you're trying to take care of business.
Does it bother you to do the same thing, or is it always different to you?
There is some variety in it. If I didn't enjoy doing it, I couldn't do it as much as I do. So I guess I enjoy some repetition, you know, and it is a repeat process, definitely a repeat process. But there's always something different going on, and the seasons change. So in the spring, in the summer, in the fall, you're watching out for deer. In the wintertime, you're watching out for patches of ice, and all the time you're watching out for that idiot coming at you, you know. So basically, if you go to sleep on the job, you're dead. You know, you don't survive it. You hurt somebody, and so you have to pay attention to what you're doing.
Do you enjoy your job?
Yes.
What do you enjoy about it?
I enjoy being by myself and making money. I enjoy driving truck. Yeah, I enjoy the speed too. I enjoy travel, movement.
How about you, Alan? What kind of work are you doing now?
Well, I do a lot of different kinds of work, but my main work is designing clothing, designing very special, one-of-a-kind, creative clothing for people to wear to express their individuality. Make clothing for original people. And so that's what I mainly do, but there's times where I have my slack time where I'm not working all the time, and during that time, I take care of the family a little bit more, cook them more dinners, and clean the house now and then. And then I also teach aerobics. In fact, I do teach aerobics no matter what, at least 2 days a week. So I think that's about it. Mostly just being a mother, a wife, a designer, and my hobby is keeping my body physically fit.
Roy, how do you deal with Ellen being an extrovert?
I'm not sure that I do it very well, but basically I think it is her, it's up to her to deal with me the way I am, because I feel that if I change, it will be because I want to change, not because Ellen wants me to change. And I guess I'm just a stubborn old man, you know. How do I deal with Ellen? I let Ellen do her thing as long as she can at least give me a little bit of space.
Ellen, how do you deal with Roy's introversion?
Well, I just continue to pursue what I need to pursue, and if it means he can't go with me, then he can't go with me, and if he doesn't want to go with me, even though I think he's going to have a really good time if he does, then I just go anyway. I have to continue doing what I'm doing to be who I am. And I try to do as much as I can, I don't even know if that really goes into it, but I just continue to be who I am and hope for the best, that we can work, you know, that we can work it out together for our differences.
Something I need to say there is people do change a lot. And I feel that I have done a lot of changing since Ellen and I have been together, too. And we were more alike when we got together than we are now. We aren't.
Me too.
We aren't. We have definitely not grown together as far as.
We've gotten worse.
as far as our feelings about what needs to be done, what is important, we have grown farther apart.
Roy, how do you feel about going out a lot?
It depends on where I go. I have a large family in this area, and so I have been around my family a lot, and I can socialize with my family fairly well. I have a hard time with Ellen's club friends, the exercisers and the partiers and the play people. I can't relate to them. I feel very isolated. I find a corner and stand in it, and I don't enjoy myself very much. Unless I get really drunk, and then
he has a good time.
And then I have
like
a good
at
time.
Our party. He had a good time at our party here.
I got really drunk.
How about you, Ellen? How do you feel if circumstances are such that you can't go out and get away and sort of and do the social things that are so much part of you? How do you feel when that happens?
I feel very stifled. I feel like I'm not that I belong out there in the limelight. You know, I kind of belong out there dressed in pretty clothing and walking around. You know, I just feel that I'm a part of that scene. And so when I'm not a part of that scene, it feels awkward. It feels, I feel like I'm not in the right place. You know, that I feel like I need to go out and do that to be who I am.
Roy, do you think people accept you for what you are, or do they try to change you?
I think I am resented in a lot of ways because I'm not as nice a person as a lot of people would like me to be. But at least what I tell these people is, at least I'm not bothering you. You know, leave me alone and we'll be just fine, you know. I usually get in trouble for not communicating, and then when it finally comes out, when I finally get angry and everything, everybody says, "Ooh, you shouldn't be saying that now. You know, that's too much. We didn't like that." You know, and so I go back down again, and I stay there until I can't take it anymore, and then I come out, and everybody says, "Now you shouldn't do that." You know. And why don't you talk to me? And then when I talk to them, they go, "Oh, that's not nice, you know. You told me how you felt, and I didn't like it." Well, you know,
it's
then
true.
Leave me alone, you know, don't ask.
I learned not to ask.
Roy, what kind of advice would you give to people who are also in a marriage of opposites?
Try and stay cool and try and allow space, you know, try and give what you can, you know, of the entertainment or the partying and stuff, and basically still do your thing and make sure that the other person understands that you need to do your thing too. I guess basically be understanding and patient. When people are together this strongly differentiated, it really requires a lot of patience, and maybe not so much patience as just the ability to get through it. Persevere. What can I say? Try and find the things that you can do together. She enjoys music. I enjoy music. Find something you have in common and do that. And if you don't have something in common and you don't like to do what she likes to do, then allow her to do her thing and you do yours. Allow each other a lot of space. That's all I'm going to say there.
How about you, Ellen? What do you think of, if you were giving people advice about how do you deal with these kinds of differences, what would you tell them?
Well, I think I would say that, again, be patient, try to be patient with each other as much as possible. Accept each other for who they are and try to remember why you fell in love or why you got together in the first place with that person. I'm always reflecting back to what I saw in him from the beginning. What I was attracted to at the very beginning. Oh, that was a wonderful time. And then also to just keep yourself, for me, being a person that is so dependent on other people for their entertainment and everything, try to find something that you can do for yourself, you know, that will get out and go do something. If he won't go with you or whatever, then you go do it yourself and don't hesitate to do it. Do it. And you know, eventually he might come along now and then, you know, who knows? If he doesn't, then at least you'll be getting yourself independent enough to enjoy doing things on your own. And you never know when that person might not be there anymore. You know, life is pretty fragile, so you might as well get started being independent so that if that ever should happen, you would know how to be in the world on your own. And that's a hard thing for me to accept because I like people, but I think it's something that's been real good for me to do things all on my own.
Thanks, Roy and Ellen. What we've been seeing in meeting these 10 people is just the beginning of type recognition. We could go on and take each one of the four functions and look at it in each one of the four positions. For example, how it is when it's the first function or the second or auxiliary function, how it shows itself when it's the third function or when it's the fourth or inferior function. But we've seen enough to get started, and what we have to do is practice this scale of type recognition in our own lives. There's just one final and very important point I'd like to make. Type recognition is just part of what Jung meant by psychological types. The other part is type development or inner transformation. What that means is that we can go on what Jung calls the process of individuation by way of typology. By starting from our more developed first and second functions and working our way down and trying to get in touch with our third and then our fourth functions is equivalent to the very thing Jung described as a journey to wholeness. So we can't separate type recognition from the whole rest of Jung's psychology. Now, if you're interested in what this process of inner transformation is like from the point of view of typology, I suggest you become familiar with Jung's writings, especially his book Psychological Types, and other things in the Jungian literature, like Marie-Louise von Franz's little book, The Inferior Function. I've also written some things about that with my wife, Tira, who's the person behind the camera. And one of them is a practical guide to Jung's typology. It describes what it's like to go on the journey to individuation through typology. It also brings Jung's psychological types together with body types, which I think there's a real connection there. Now, we have a second book, which is a more advanced guide to Jung's typology, and again, its connection with Sheldon's body and temperament types, and to the kind of biochemical typology that could emerge out of many of the exciting discoveries that are being made today.
Great. God bless. Oh, this is hard.
I'm getting nervous.
No, don't be nervous.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. Like
I'm getting the camera.
Do I really have to? What? I just couldn't resist. Have to look at you?
No,
I just couldn't resist that. I just had to
look at her.
Feeling is stronger in me.
You know, I kind of like to hang out with kids. That seems silly, but that's the truth. I like to hang out with kids.
That's just that. God.
Oh, and I like to be watched, and I like to be looked at rather than have me look at other people. I would rather be looked at.
Way, I would much rather that camera was on her than me. And
okay, bye-bye, kids.
Bye-bye.